video series is to accompany the Cisco Netacad IT Essentials 7.0 course. This video is Chapter 10, Windows Installation. In Chapter 10, we're going to talk about modern operating systems, explain system requirements, describe the functions, describe the OS software and hardware requirements, and explain the process of upgrading an operating system. And also we're going to look at disk management and installing Windows. Modern operating systems. Some of the terms you need to know for this course and for just in general in IT. What multi-user is, that's two or more users have individual accounts that allow them to work with programs and devices at the same time. Multitasking means the computer's capable of operating multiple applications at the same time. Multiprocessing means that the operating system can support two or more CPUs. And multi-threading means that a program can be broken into smaller parts that are loaded as needed by the operating system. And multi-threading allows different parts of a program to be run at the same time. The OS boots the computer and manages the file systems. And operating systems can support more than one task, user, or CPU at a time. The basic functions of an operating system. The OS manages the interaction between the applications and the hardware. It creates a file structure on the hard disk to store data. It enables the user to interact with the software and hardware. And it locates an application and loads it into RAM of the computer. The recent Windows operating systems include Windows 7, Windows 8, 8.1, Windows 10, and now Windows 11. When you're looking at installing an operating system, you need to make sure that the hardware is compatible, and you also need to make sure that the operating system is going to be compatible with the customer. So does the customer use off-the-shelf applications for this computer? So off-the-shelf applications specify a list of compatible OS systems on the application package, or does the customer use customized applications that were programmed specifically for the customer and run with specific requirements? When you're looking at operating systems, you need to make sure that you're looking at the minimum hardware requirements. This is a chart here for Windows 10, 8, 1, and 7. The difference between 32-bit and 64-bit processor architecture. 32-bit processes multiple instructions using a 32-bit address space. It supports 32-bit OS. It supports a maximum of 4 gig of RAM. 64-bit adds additional registers. It's backwards compatible with 32-bit processors software, and it supports 32-bit and 64-bit operating systems. Now, when you check the OS compatibility, an OS must be upgraded periodically to remain compatible with the latest hardware and software. But before upgrading the operating system, you want to check the minimum hardware requirements of the new operating system to ensure that it can be installed successfully. Microsoft provides Get Windows 10 application, and now they have Get Windows 11 or Windows 11 update systems to check to make sure that your hardware is available for Windows 11. And they also have, you can also get it through Windows Update Service on computers running Windows 7 and Windows 8.1 to see if it's upgradable to Windows 10. The version of an operating system determines the available upgrade options. For example, a 32-bit operating system cannot be upgraded to a 64-bit operating system. Windows 7 and 8 can be upgraded to Windows 10, but Windows Vista and XP cannot. And to upgrade Windows 7 or Windows 8 to Windows 10, you need to use the Windows 10 Update Assistant available on the Download Windows 10 website. And now with Windows 11, you'll need to be checking into that as far as upgrading to Windows 11. And then computers running Windows XP and Windows Vista do not have the upgrade path to Windows 10, and they require a clean installation. When you're installing an operating system, you need to also look at data migration. When a new operating system is installed, the data needs to be migrated from the old operating system to the new one. You can use the user state migration tool, or USMT. It's a command line utility to simplify user state migration. You can also use the Windows Easy Transfer when switching from an old computer to a new one, or PC Mover Express. That's a tool for transferring selected files, folders, profiles from a Windows PC to a Windows 10 PC. And there's plenty of aftermarket tools that will also help you migrate data. Installing Windows. When you're installing Windows, you need to first look at the, well, look at the architecture of the motherboard, but is it 32-bit or 64-bit? Is it going to support what you need? But then you next need to look at the storage device types. The two most common types of data storage devices are hard disk drives and flash memory-based drives, such as solid-state drives and USB drives. When the storage device type has been chosen, it must be prepared to receive the new operating system, and modern operating systems ship with an installer program. Installers usually prepare the disk and install the operating system. When you are partitioning a hard drive, you find and launch the operating system. Usually the operating system is going to take care of the partitioning for you, and it'll walk you through a series of steps. It's the responsibility of the computer firmware, which needs to know the partition scheme. So two partition scheme standards are Master Boot Record, or MBR, and Globally Unique Identifier, or GUID, partition table. The master boot record contains information on how the hard drive partitions are organized. The MBR is 512 bytes long. It contains the bootloader, an executable program that allows a user to choose from multiple operating systems. And the MBR is commonly used in computers with BIOS-based firmware. And then you have GUID partition table. That's designed as a partition table scheme standard for hard drives. And the GPT makes use of a number of modern techniques to expand on the older MBR partitioning scheme. And GPT is commonly used in computers with UEFI firmware. Now you can have partitions in logical drives. The primary partition contains the OS files, and it's usually the first partition. On MBR disk, the active partition is used to store and boot an OS. And if more than four partitions are needed on an MBR disk, one partition can be designated an extended partition. And then a logical drive is a section of an extended partition. It's used to separate information for administrative purposes. And a basic disk, the default, contains partitions such as primary and extended, as well as logical drives, which are formatted for data storage. And then a dynamic disk can create volumes that span across more than one disk. And then formatting creates a file system on a partition for file storage. The different file systems that you'll come across, they differ in properties and speed, flexibility, security, and size. And some of the most common ones are file allocation table, or 32-bit, or FAT32. That supports partition sizes up to 2 terabytes, and it's used by Windows XP or earlier OS versions. And then you have new technology file system, or NTFS. That supports partition sizes up to 16 exabytes. NTFS incorporates file system security features and extended attributes. And then you have EXFAT, or FAT64, that created to address some of the limitations of FAT32 and NTFS when formatting USB flash drives, such as file size and directory size. One of the primary advantages of XFAT is that it can support files larger than 4 gigabyte. And then you have compact disk file system, or CDFS, that was created specifically for optical disk media. And then you have NFS, network file system. That's a network-based file system. It allows files access over the network. It's an open standard which allows anyone to implement it. Installation and boot sequence. When you create an account on the operating system, authentication is when users enter a username and a password to access a user account. Windows uses a single sign-on, or SSO, authentication, which allows users to log in once to access all system resources. User accounts allow multiple users to share a single computer using their own files and settings. And then Windows 10 offers two different types of accounts, administrator and standard user. Administrator accounts have complete control over a computer, well, almost complete control, and users with this type of account can change settings globally and install programs, while standard user accounts have limited control, and then users with this type of account can run applications, but they cannot install programs. When you install an operating system on multiple computers, it does take time. To simplify this, administrators usually use a computer to act as a base system and go through the regular operating system installation process. And then after that, the base computer is set up. A specific program is used to duplicate all of the information on that disk, and then it copies it to another disk, and that's usually an external device. And now that contains a fully deployed operating system, and it can then be put in the new computer and brought up to speed. If an undesirable setting is accidentally included during the base installation, an administrator can use Microsoft Systems Prep tool to remove it before creating the final image. There's other ways to do installation. You can do a network installation that includes pre-boot execution environment, or PXE installation. unattended installation, and remote installation. You also have image-based internal partition installation. That's a Windows image stored on an internal, often hidden partition that can be used to restore Windows to its original state. And then you also have Windows Advanced startup options such as refreshing your PC, upgrading and repairing your installation, remote network installation, recovering a partition, and refreshing and restoring. The remote network installation, that allows the operating system install files that are stored on, to be stored on a server, and then the client computer can access those files remotely. And then a software package such as Remote Installation Services, or RIS, communicates with the client, stores the setup files, and then proceeds with the installation process. You can have an unattended network installation. To perform a Windows unattended installation, setup.exe must run with the user options found in the answer file. Instead of prompting the user, the setup uses answers listed within the file. So instead of going through and asking about keyboard and location and different things like that, it's all put into a setup file and created with the installation process. You can have a recovery partition. Some Windows computers contain a section of the disk that's inaccessible to the user, and that partition has a recovery partition. It contains an image that can be used to restore the computer to its original configuration. Now you can do an in-place upgrade that will update the operating system and migrate apps over. The System Center Configuration Manager task sequence can be used to completely automate the process. And when upgrading Windows 7 or Windows 8 to Windows 10, the Windows installation program will perform an in-place upgrade, and it automatically preserves all data, settings, applications, and drivers. Or you can have a clean install, and that's another way to upgrade to a newer version of Windows. Is a clean install, you remove everything off the disk and do a full install from a clean standpoint. When we're looking at the Windows boot sequence, after the POST, the power on self test, the BIOS locates and reads the configuration settings stored in the CMOS. The boot device priority is the order in which the devices are checked to locate the bootable partition. And then the BIOS boots the computer using the first drive that contains a valid boot sector. And this sector contains the master boot record. And the master boot record identifies the volume boot record, which then loads the boot manager, which for Windows is bootmgr.exe. And then hard drives, network drives, USB drives, and even removable media can be used in the boot order, depending on the capabilities of the motherboard. Windows 7 has different startup modes. You have safe mode, which is a diagnostic mode used to troubleshoot Windows and Windows startup. It's limited in functionality. Safe mode with networking starts with as in the same as safe, but it gives you networking support. And then safe mode with command prompt starts Windows and loads the command prompt instead of the GUI. And then the last known good configuration loads the last configuration settings that were used the last time the Windows was started successfully. Windows 8 and Windows 10 startup modes. Both Windows 8 and Windows 10 boot quickly to use and you use F8 to access the startup settings. Instead, what you want to do is hold the shift key and select the restart option in the power menu. This will display the choose and options screen to get to the startup settings, then select troubleshoot, then from the next screen, select advanced options, and then inside the advanced options, select startup settings. And then on the next screen, you select restart. And then to choose a startup option, use the number function keys F1 through F9 that corresponds to the desired option.